So this morning I'm going to be talking about something that for some reason we in the body of Christ, we in the church maybe don't talk enough about. And it's the personality of the personalities in the Word of God. Amen. Very often we speak about the David, yes, I've got the anointing of David, I'm going to slay the Goliath. We know that's one. Amen. Or we're like, yes, I'm going to seek the Lord like Solomon. I'm going to seek the Lord's wisdom. Amen. Or you say, yes, I'm going to be like Jeremiah. I'm going to be a weeping prophetic voice before the Lord. Amen. Or you say, yes, I want to be like Isaiah. I want to have throne room encounters. Amen. But there's so many more that we don't talk about. There's so many anointings that maybe we have forgotten. There's so many anointings. There's so many stories. There's so many lessons. So much purpose in so many of these stories that I believe that the Lord is going to start highlighting to us. And I'm going to call them almost the people that have become minors. The minor people in the Word of God. You with me?
Yes.
The minor people that maybe we have forgotten about. And this particular story I'm going to be talking about that I'm going to highlight to you this morning spans four chapters in the Word of God. Four. I felt so embarrassed and I felt so convicted by the Lord because last week when I was preparing for this message, I couldn't find the book of Ruth. I need to come to Ruth.
Yes.
Especially as you're a woman of the Bible. So I need to come because I had to go to my index to find the book of Ruth. It's that small. Now, I'm not in the Old Testament. Do I get points for that? See, I'm confessing my sins. I've got no qualms about what I know and what I don't. I'm not shy. Amen. I believe that I need to know what I don't know so I can correct it. Hallelujah. That is my motto. That is my motto of life. I need to know what I don't know so that I can correct that. How can you correct something that you don't know that you don't know?
Amen.
So, here I am. So, look at the and I go forward, it's like that situation with sellotape. You know when you're looking for the stored mares of sellotape, man? And you feel I've gone around it a few times.
Yeah.
So then you start going backwards. But you're like, I just used this thing this morning. So you got to sellotape and you're going in and you're like, surely I've gone around it five times. And you go backwards. And then the nail comes out. And your nail just starts getting aggressive. And you start clawing at the sellotape like a wild animal. Is it only me?
No, it's the
it must just be us teachers. I don't know. It's genuinely. It's like the sellotape is just there to mock you. It's like they had a convention and they just decided they're going to mock you, the sellotape. But anyway, that's how I felt about finding the book of Ruth. So here I am. And he just says, Ellie, come and hold the mic, please. So I started now. I start like, you know, towards Isaiah or something. So I'm going and I'm kings now. Surely I've gone past maybe it's further in Psalm, Isaiah. The sellotape was one of those moments. And then about the sixth time, I said, Lord, I'm ashamed. And I sent to the index to find the book of Ruth. And the book of Ruth comes just after where it should come. Well, that's where it's been placed. The book of Judges. So for the record, the book of Ruth, if you are looking for now, which you should be, it comes after the book of Judges. Thank you.
Thank you.
Are we clarified? Oh, Lord, we'll take the word. Anyway, so I've called my message this morning, call me Ruth. Think about it. There are so many stories and so many anointings that we want from the Word of God, and we should want them. Amen.
Amen.
We must want them. They are there. They are demonstrated to us to show us the kinds of things that the Lord is able to do.
Yeah, amen.
Like Daniel. Amen. We must desire Daniel anointing.
Yeah.
We must desire a Davidic anointing. We must desire a peace that's there. But I believe that the Lord is saying to us right now, and I'm not sure if this is going to become more than just us, but I believe the Lord is saying we need to desire the anointing of Ruth. And we mustn't just desire it. It must become us. Because it is one of the most important scriptures, I believe, right now, of what the Lord is saying to the people of God. We know that the Lord is talking about holiness. We know that the Lord is talking about humility. We know that the Lord is talking about gray areas, but I believe the Lord is also saying, I am looking for roots. I am looking for those who can pick up their hand and say, yes, I am a Ruth in the house of God. Yes, I am a Ruth in the kingdom of God. Yes, I am a Ruth in the church of God. Call me Ruth. Why did I say call me Ruth? Because it was prophesied. Before it was prophesied, I think it was in Rachel. We read songs of us. Oh, maybe there were only three ministries that souls of the Lord. I think it was in Rachel. I don't even know if I was praying over her. She was standing next to her. And the Lord spoke to me that there is a renaming coming. Yeah. Remember that?
Yeah.
There's a renaming coming to the body of Christ.
Yes.
There's a new name. And the Lord showed me prophetically that there was stone. Was big and was strong and looked like it was an old stone, and on that they looked like what could have been a name, but it was fading away. And on that, this all happened while, you know, anyway. So while this is all happening, I saw the hand of the Lord sketching on the stone a name. I couldn't identify that name at the moment, but I don't believe it is one particular name. I believe it is a process of renaming. That is what the Lord was showing me. Amen. Renaming. So when I was thinking about this, I believe that the Lord is saying that he's looking to rename many in the body of Christ, much within our personalities, much within our anointings. The Lord is looking to rename us.
Wow.
Rename us, Ruth. To the point where we can say, yes, call me Ruth, because that is who I am.
Wow.
That is who I am in the eyes of the Lord. That is who I am in the body of Christ. That is who I am in the people around me. I did not know this. I didn't know this. I don't know if you know this. But the name Ruth translated means friend.
Wow.
The name Ruth translated means friend. Friend. And some variations will say it means intimate. Is what I believe the Lord is saying to us today. Call me. You need to be able to say unto the Lord. You need to be able to say unto the person sitting next to you, call me friend. Okay, and as a side note, if you can run into our community. You guys have seen this thing with the cat, this meme that is going around.
Yeah.
You've seen it, yeah. So now there's this meme that's going around. There's this one lady, there's two ladies, and the one is really angry and she's screaming at her cat something. And everyone's just changing the meme, and then the cat is like just and like overly salacious. It's a white cat and he's going to do it. So, Apostle Lighton was the best for me so far. And then the lady, I'm going to do it like I'm going to do it. The lady's screaming, you said 2019 is going to be my year!
That's
it. I said, tell your name. Spiritual. it also means something. The Lord is saying that I've set you a part in a family life. This is where it's a teaching example. I've set you a part in a biological family. Like with Ruth, right? She was part of a biological family. But the time came when the Lord created and moved things around and shifted things in the experience where she had to become part of a new family. And this family became a new spiritual family. Amen. How do we know this? We know this because when Ruth married her husband, her mother-in-law was named Naomi. And now sadly and very tragically, Ruth's husband died. Ruth did not go back to her family. She stayed with her mother-in-law. And she famously said, your people will be my people and your God will be my God.
Wow.
Do you see that there's a spiritual nature to the separation that's happened? So there is Ruth. Married, the husband died, or whatever, whatever. There were two of them actually that married into the same family, but that's not the point. My point is, she allowed herself to become spiritually linked. Mm. You with me?
Yes.
Spiritually linked to her new family that she really knew. The Lord is looking for some roots right now who will spiritually link themselves to a family. Spiritually linked. Who will say, your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. How many of you are sitting in here right now and you're not fully planted? You might have been coming here for 80 years, but you might not be planted. You might have been coming here for 8 years, but you might have not fully said, your people are my people. Your God is my God. I am part of this family, and that is what is happening in the body of Christ right now. The Lord is looking to some new spiritual. The Lord is looking to bring in people from all different walks of life, from all different personalities, from all different worlds, to be part of something regardless of the tragedy. Regardless of the tragedy, regardless of the challenge, regardless of the sacrifice, regardless of what happens on a personal level, you will be able to say, your people are my people. Your God is my God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And that's the problem that's happening right now. And I don't believe I'm speaking to this to any of you, but that's the problem that's happening right now. We've still got too many people who are wanting to serve in families on their own terms. They're not wanting to just be there and be part of the family and to be part of this thing regardless of the challenges. Because Naomi was willing to release Ruth to go and marry or whatever, whatever, because she didn't have any more sons. Am I right? She didn't have any more children that they could marry, but instead, Ruth made the decision, the hard decision. She knew life was going to be tough. She knew life was going to be tough for them as two women, living in a time where they needed men, where men were supposed to be allowed them, and she made the sacrifice. 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 Not just out of loyalty, but sacrifice out of covenant.
Wow, yes, amen.
Sacrifice out of commitment to not just this woman, but to the family that she had now chosen to align herself to.
Amen. Amen.
Sacrifice of herself. Sacrifice of what? We don't really know too much of her. Well, if she was wealthy, we don't know more. We don't know how many siblings she had. I'm not sure if we do know. But I didn't come across it. It wasn't important to me. What was important to me was the newness. This relationship that was now forged in covenant. You remember that she would have in some form or other made a covenant with her husband to say, in sickness and in health, something to us part. Death did their part. Death did their part. But that wasn't strong enough to break the covenant with the family. Ooh, I feel like a godfather right now. I teach PC God as well. Michael Corleone, Godfather. Amen. And that's the thing that happened that's supposed to happen. Okay, forgive me, but tomorrow I might be in the newspapers saying this. The church almost has to become like, let me say this church. This church, this body, almost has to become like a mafia. Like a mafia. Yeah. If people even look at your family, we all go, we just jump in.
Amen.
That's mafia style, you know. You say, My presence here goes beyond covenant. And the Lord is looking to, for people right now to install this anointing of people who understand covenant.
Yes.
People who understand what it means to commit yourself. I know what it's like. I know what it's like when things are tough. Friends are?
Yes.
When things are tough, friends are feeling. Why? Because we have to call for the Lord anointing. That's why. Because the body of Christ has been called out for the Ruth anointing to come upon the people of God, to come upon our families, so that we will truly, the word tells us that Ruth, that she will cleave to her. She will attach herself to her. And that's why I hate with all the passion that I have, before I even had the spirit of rejection, I hate a covenant breaking spirits. And I've said this for years, I hate a covenant breaking spirit. It is a desecrator of relationships. United. I could just go to the story of Pentecost. united in one spirit, and because of that unity, the Spirit of God fell. Amen. So there is power when we are united. Now, it makes me sad when people choose not to be united. And it makes me sad because it is Antichrist. It is a spirit of isolation, and it is a spirit of independence that has come upon the body of Christ, but it is not of the Lord. Amen. And these are hard words because we all know these people. We all know people who choose to live out their relationship with the Lord like who? Who, Robin? Like Robin Island. There should be no Robins in the body of Christ. Jesus demonstrated this in his walk on the earth. He didn't have to, he didn't need it. He embodied God on the earth, and yet he chose to have a company of people. He chose to live and work and impart and minister to these men and women. So how can we go around and say, no, no, we, you know, whatever, Lone Ranger this, Lone Ranger that, you are now the church, and you know what, the place, you can find another one and put one down there.
Yes.
There's a revolution that has started coming to the churches. A revolution where people are realizing the hurt and the discrimination and whatever, whatever that has happened over all the years. And that's grace. So we've got no more excuse. If in the whole of the Free State you have to travel to this church because there's no discrimination, then great, travel. But don't make excuses. Don't say that there's no place for you to go. Ruth didn't make an excuse because her husband died. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
She didn't make an excuse to not feel sorry for herself or to go back and to, I don't know, do weird things. She didn't make an excuse because Ruth, and what the Lord is saying to us today is we need to understand the importance and the strength and the value, and listen to this, the blessing.
Amen.
The blessing that comes through and by covenant.
Amen.
There is a blessing. Put this out whenever you put things out. There is a blessing in covenant. There is a blessing that flows through covenant. There is a blessing that flows by covenant. And now I'll give you a practical demonstration of this. My own covenant with my own overseer. My own covenant with my own apostle. It is not something that I have forced and wanted, but it's something I've wanted. Right? And as such, I believe that part of what we see around us the extension of the ministry is because there is a blessing, there is an anointing that flows when we honor, especially those who are in covenant with.
Yes. Yeah, amen.
There are others who have tried, there are others who have not honored, there are others who have not fully received of that covenant and that anointing, and I can tell you today, they know me. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
We need to understand, like Ruth understood, the value and the importance of spiritual covenant. The Lord is looking for roots on the earth today.
Amen.
The Lord is looking for people to say, yes, I understand and I value covenant.
Amen.
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 Who? And my favorite thing is what? Who and what? Are you in covenant with right now? Who and what are you in covenant with right now? Who and what are you in covenant with right now? Some of us are in covenant with many people. Our hearts are there. Some of us are in covenant with other people's husbands and wives. Our hearts are there. We should not be those people do not belong to us. Get your hands, get your emotions, get your thoughts off somebody else's spouse.
Amen.
Some of us are covenant with demonic forces, spirits of lies and of jealousy and of all these other kind of funny things that we are covenant with those things because we willfully and intentionally engage. Who and what are you in covenant with? What anointing or curse are you getting from that which you are in covenant with? Hallelujah!
Yeah.
Oh, this is what we are. I didn't plan to say any of this. Right, we are. So let's move back to Bethlehem. Blah, 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 blah. Ruth chapter 2. Now, Naomi had a relative on her husband's side. Abimelech, whose name was Boaz. And Ruth the Moabite said to Naomi, let me go to the fields and pick up the leftover grain behind anyone whose eyes I find faith. Now here's the situation. The scriptures don't tell us this, but I think at this point they're hungry. Amen. Can we agree? They go back to Bethlehem and Naomi's still trying to get rid of Ruth. Maybe she's got a bit of food, but she's like, this food might last for a week. I don't have the time to feed another mouth. And then Ruth on her own, because she values covenant. She says, let me go to the fields where the men, where the people are busy chopping down whatever, and I will go behind them. I will go behind them, and I will pick up the scraps that I can find, because I'm in covenant with you. I will feed us, because I'm in covenant with you. I love you. I'm in covenant with you. I will go on my knees on the field of a stranger.
Amen.
Because we're in covenant. Sure. Call me Ruth. That's who I am. I will go on my knees. I will shame myself. I will bow low because I'm humble in the sight of the Lord.
Yes.
Amen. I have no pride within me. I have no stubbornness within me. I will do what I need to do for this family.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. I will do what I need to. Imagine this, guys. Imagine this. Maybe we don't have things right now. I don't know that your only thing would have to tell us the people from the former community how it works. But imagine you go to, pick and pay. When they're offloading mealy meal. And they're just taking hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of sacks of mealy meal. And as they're throwing the sacks of mealy meal, little bits are laying on the floor. And you come with a little kind of paper plate. And you're on your knees. And as the mealy meal or whatever, you're going in with a paper plate to try and catch little bits of mealy meal so that you and your family can be sustained. Call me Ruth. Call me Ruth. So she said to Naomi, don't worry. I'm going to handle this. We're in covenant together. I'm not going to let us stop. Not me, not you. I'm not going to let us stop. You see, when you come into covenant, me and you disappear.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
When you come into covenant, there's no me and you, there's us. The body of Christ is in us. Is in us. Amen. So here it is. Naomi said to her, go ahead, my daughter. So she went out and into the field and began to glean behind the harvest. Just go back to the title page, please. And I love this image. I love what it shows about who we are meant to be. I love what it shows what it means to be you. I love what it shows what it means to be humble. I love what it shows to do backbreaking work. There's nothing there. There's no evidence of mealies or weed or soybeans. It's the leftovers. But there is a humility and a determination and a resilience to go out and to intentionally, because the family needs it. When I don't feel like praying, when I'm exhausted, when I am tired, the Spirit of the Lord says to me, you gotta glean.
Yes.
You gotta glean, your family are struggling. You gotta glean at the feet of the King. You gotta pick up even the strength of my strength. Don't tell me that you cannot pray for your people. Don't tell me that you don't have time to repeat the message. Don't tell me that you don't have time to go to prayer practice. Don't have time to tell me that you don't have time to go to prayer. You gotta glean. You gotta glean. You gotta go to the fields of God, to the courts of heaven, to the fields of abundance, and you gotta humble yourself. who understands wealth, a man who understands the workers, a man who understands relationship, a man who understands that God is the master. He needs these servants. You getting me? I'm going to this. He needs them. The Lord bless you, they answered. Boaz asked the overseer of his harvest, who does that young woman belong to? In other words, where did she come from? What is she doing here? Why is she being taken out of the scripts? The overseer replied, she is the Moab woman who came back from Moab with Naomi. She said, please let me glean and gather among the sheep we had. She came into the field and has remained here from morning till now, except for a short rest in the shelter. Ruth was there from morning till the evening. She took a short rest, but she was gleaning. She was gleaning. She humbled herself to that gleaning. She didn't abandon her family. She could have easily have said to Naomi, hey, why do I want to stay here with you? I'm still young again. Now look at this. I'll get a man tomorrow. And the romantic pops of the taxi and the whole staff will pour out their welcome. That's going to be my story. Thank you very much. I might be poor today, but tomorrow people offer me $45,000 jewelry and smartphones and free makeup. Don't you come talk to me now? Hallelujah!
Amen.
No. She didn't do that. She failed when things get tough. Family don't do that.
Amen.
People in covenant don't do that. You're not supposed to do that. Why? Because the one is to come when you stick to God.
Yeah, amen.
Yes. Amen.
Woo. Now here's this man. Already his entrance into the story. For me, when I read this, I imagine a very dramatic. So there's everyone, you know, people with blood, sweat, and tears picking up, and the workers are chopping. And there's this man, I imagine coming with a staff. A Jewish men were allowed and permitted to carry a staff. I think that's the life he's going to play here. Right, I'm going to use this as an illustration. So I imagine Boaz, and I imagine with a cool thing on his head, similar to the one of the kings. You know, because he's wealthy, right? And certain clothes and certain things about him had to show a certain level of status. So I imagine Boaz driving at the stage walking. And I believe that as he's walking, his color, you know, he probably had royal colors, his color caused people to stop. But here's the thing, because he values their lives, he pleases them first.
Wow.
He extends grace.
Wow. Yeah.
Amen.
He extends grace first. Before they even looked up from their place of ground, before they even looked up from their place of nothingness, he comes in all his radiance, in all his glory, and he extends grace, and not just grace, blessings. Wow! One man, good man. Wow. And let's talk about prophecy. Don't go in your doubts. I'm giving you a new place and I'm giving you a new place. She was in covenant here, and now the Lord is extending that covenant. He's making the space and the platform of covenant even bigger. He is welcoming her without even asking. Ruth did not go up and beg. He came to Ruth, like Jesus does to all of us. Jesus comes and he presents himself before us. He presents his grace, he presents his love, he presents his mercy, he presents his favor, he presents the protection that comes. But here's the thing, Ruth could have said, I'm really imperfect, I don't even know you. Suga, come in and meet him on me on day one. I'm waiting there, I have another one there. No. She didn't reject what the Lord was offering. She didn't reject the favor. You see, this is how it works in the body of Christ. Jesus presents himself. He presents himself in first of all who he is, and then he presents himself in what he can offer us. And we can either choose to reject it, or we can choose to say, yes, I'm coming back. Where are you? Are you a Ruth? Have you agreed to the terms of the abundance of the Lord? Have you said, yes, I'm coming back? Have you said all of those things, or have you said, no? I'm not a Ruth. I'm a flip-flopper. You know what happens to people who wear flip-flops? Marcel is not from the video, she knows what this is. I only knew it was going 2 seconds ago, but it's going. It's going down, it's happening, it's not a drill. I want everyone who's worn a pair of flip-flops to tell me if in all the years you have worn flip-flops, it wasn't like what happens to me a good 3-4 times a week. That's not to mention 5 times a day. Someone taps your toes. The kids in my class are getting bigger. One is here. When I first started teaching him, he was here. It's the joy of teaching now is here. So which means he's bigger. People with flip-flops. And who by extension of the flops in every church. And I tell you what, I'm not sure which is worse. You guys must help me here. Please, my friends, my roots. Which is worse? The harder. The Lord needs to clearly deliver me from trauma. To get burnt by hot coffee, or to have your open toes checked. Because both of those feel like in that moment you are going to die. Both of those feel like in that moment you swear for angels. You swear that they can open that. Amen.
So he decided he's going to
it better than you?
It's coming.
You all with me?
Hallelujah.
Nice little of twins. Yeah, I can help
you. Is that big enough, Apostle?
Oh, this I see, but it's yours. Of coming. she refused to pray for her. She refused to say, oh, well, hang around, that's fine. Your partner, and then y'all will see me. Some people do that. The minute somebody new or a new form of covenant comes in, they forget the other covenants. Amen. We allow people, we allow things, we allow new, shiny, silver carrots to cause us to turn our back on those we are in covenant with. The situation with Ruth was a day one situation, but she accepted. The situation with Ruth was very new. But she said, yes, this guy is in charge. There's something about him. There's a decency. There's an honesty. I don't know him really that well yet. Many of us are even new to the Lord, and you say, I don't know fully this man Jesus. I don't know fully this Holy Spirit business. But there's something about him.
Hallelujah.
There's something about him. There's something about him that causes me to respond in this way. So I'm gonna throw it all in again. Amen. I'm gonna go. Because she believed in the promise. Give it God, stand up and raise your hands. Shout hallelujah for the promise.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah for the promise.
Hallelujah.
And then you may be seated. How do we know that there was a promise? Because Boaz said to her, I told the men not to lay hand on you. There was a promise right there. There was a promise of protection. There was a promise of shelter. There was a promise of nurturing. There was a promise of love. Amen.
Amen.
And better still, you will never be thirsty again.
Wow.
Sound like Jesus?
Yes.
Absolutely. And this she did what? She stood up and gave him, you know, the vine thing. Like we do when we feel we're not getting the best thing from the Lord. Only water. I'm going to be here working in this field. You promised me only water. I want fruit, I want bread, and I want to leave home at 4 o'clock.
Sure.
If you do that to the Lord,
yes, it's true.
Spirit of gratitude, yes. Long live, yes. Spirit of gratitude, yes. Long live hope with thankfulness and humility. And here is the Lord in the manifestation of Boaz, and the church in the manifestation of Ruth. What does she do? She bows down with her face to the ground.
Jesus.
And then like Isaiah did, when he had thrown her encounter, she says, why have I found such favor that you notice me? I'm a foreigner. I'm a stranger. I'm a quiddy. Oh, Jesus. He doesn't care where we come from. Mm-hmm. He doesn't care what we look like.
Amen.
He doesn't care how long we know him for. He knows us.
Amen.
And he knows our story.
Amen.
He knows our backstory.
Amen.
He knows our challenges.
Yes.
And when we come to that place saying, yes, I'm going to be in the fields. I'm going to be scrambling. I'm going to be scraping. He comes to us with grace and favor and love. And he extends upon us. He extends his favor. And Ruth, Tishbe, responded promptly.
Yes.
Thank you. When I spoke at conference, I mentioned it about 20 times in a row. You've got to find yourself in a position where you respond appropriately. You respond appropriately. You respond appropriately. You respond appropriately. What is the appropriate response to the Lord?
Face down.
Humility. And thanksgiving.
Yeah, amen.
Humility and thanksgiving. We don't know what the church is going to hold. Heck is only the one. But she's humble and she's faithful. Some of us, we want like a timeline. Okay, so after how many months in the church will I be able to do this? Okay, so when will I get promoted to be at this? Okay, when is that? Okay, when do I get to do the whole group? Okay. Amen. Instead of just bowing down in humility and in thanks and saying, wow, I'm a foreigner, and yet still you are so kind to me. Verse 11, Boaz replied, I've been told all about what you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband. Now you left your father and your mother-in-law. I know your story. In other words, said, I know your story. I know your heart.
Yes.
I know your struggles. Amen. Verse 12. Listen to this now. You pay attention.
Amen.
Verse 12. May the Lord repay you for what you have done. May the Lord richly, may you be richly rewarded by the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge.
Wow.
Who's speaking?
Wow. Sure.
Who's speaking? Is it Ruth or Boaz? Who's speaking? Ruth or Boaz? It doesn't matter to Jesus. It doesn't matter how long he's known you for. It doesn't matter what your backstory is.
Amen.
He's inviting you over to the table.
Amen.
Is this word not getting you excited?
It is.
If it's not, I'm going to sit down right now. Amen. I thought you'd be hopping out of your seats by now.
Amen.
Clapping and cheering at the word of the Lord, because this just leaves me mind blown, like emoticon mind blown. Wow. When she sat down with the harvesters, he offered them some roasted bread. She ate pikinyan. Did she eat pikinyan?
No.
Did she eat a little? How much did she eat? And she wanted. And that is the craziest thing about the Lord, but opposite is also the craziest thing about the church right now. We have forgotten that we need to have all we want. Come on, this generation, you gotta realize that in the Lord we get to have all we want. The Word of God tells us that Jesus Himself is a good Father. He will not give to a child slaves when He asks for bread.
Amen.
He is a good God. But the thing is, where are we and how are we responding to His favor and His goodness? Are we throwing it back in His face?
Sure.
Are we complaining? Are we angry? Are we bitter? Are we allowing all the sorts of nonsense and things to interfere with our sight? What the Lord is doing. Verse 15, as she got up to go again, Boaz gave orders to his men. Let her gather among the sheaves and don't reprimand her. Even pull out some stalks for her from the bundles and leave them for her to pick up. In other words, give her access. Give her access. Give her more than she's even able to carry. I'm in a situation right now where I've had to make a tough decision. So let me make a plan. Don't get distracted, stay with me. Are you there?
Yeah.
I'm in a situation right now where I had to make a really tough decision. It was a painful, I experienced something really painful, let me put it that way. I experienced something extremely painful and something extremely hurtful. And like any good person in covenant will do, I told everything to my apostle, and I was so piping hot and so angry I could really believe that. And like the wise woman that she is, she didn't answer me. She listened to the voice note. And she did all, She knew that she didn't need to engage in my tension. Because if she had to engage in my tension, she would have to come into the playpen of chaos. What is my point? My point is she ignored me for more than 24 hours and I hated it. Of course I hated it, but thank you. So yesterday afternoon, like nothing happened in the hotel. Narush! How are you doing? How are you feeling today?
Well, Pastor, how are you?
And then I'm still not over what happened. I was like, no, it's not that. It was like, so I didn't embarrass myself a second time. Thank you, Jesus. We do that, you know. So this time I typed out the message. And she says to me, Rosh, did you even enjoy this? And she says to me, Rosh, it is God. Give it to the Lord.
Yeah.
You know what to do. Don't know. Yo, I hate to get on the yo!
These are the days of Elijah.
Right. I'm monetize. I'm talking about government covenants. Those that you are in contact with are your new friend who sticks closer than a brother. Are you a friend that understands that covenant is more than blood ties? In closing this is what the scripture, what? Verse of the day, a new version of music. And I said this morning, I said, okay, Holy Spirit, I got the message. Because the message is, blessed are the merciful.
Wow.
For they will be shown mercy.
Amen.
Wow. Ruth showed great mercy to Naomi. An older lady who didn't have anybody. She didn't have to stick around, but she understood covenant. She stuck through thick and thin. Naomi even tried to get rid of her. Naomi said, go back, go and get married, go and you know, have fun, enjoy it. But she said, no, I'm in covenant with you.
Yes.
She chose to be merciful to Naomi in that moment, over that period, because I believe that Ruth had insight into grace.
Amen.
I believe that Ruth had supernatural insight into mercy.
Amen.
I believe that Ruth had supernatural insight into covenant. And that is why when she came across the fields of the Lord, regardless of what state it initially looked like, she was extended the same mercy.
Amen.
She was extended, not let me rephrase, greater mercy. She was extended greater grace. She was extended greater favor. She was extended promises. She was extended prophecy. And she understood that she had to respond appropriately. She understood that the only possible answer to this great favor that she did not deserve, this mercy and this grace that she did not deserve, was humility and thankfulness. The Lord is looking for roots. The Lord is looking for roots who will do like I mentioned you did. The Lord is looking for roots who will respond to grace, who will respond to favor, who will respond to mercy, who will respond to truth, who will respond to prophecy, who will respond to the word and the spirit of God. The Lord is looking to rename you. Are you ready to believe? Don't answer me. Are you ready to be renamed? There's a renaming happening in the body of Christ. There's a renaming happening. And most of the names, by the way, are minor women.
Sure.
Who've been forgotten. But that is because the woman represents the church. And the church, the true church, has been forgotten. And now the Lord is resurrecting the stories and the anointings of that that are needed right now. Is that song ready for me? I've got a song. I want to listen to the song, and after the song, Pastor, I'll wrap up.
Sure.
No, blah blah blah. Offering announcements. We go, because I want this word to be as long as possible reflected in your spirit. After the song, get ready with your offering, because Pastor, I was going to do announcement, and then we're going to go home, and we're going to reflect on who we are in our relationship. Are we a Ruth to the Lord? Are we gleaning at the fields of the Lord? Are we a Ruth to those who are in covenant with?
Amen.
If possible, I know this sounds ridiculous. Can we not have fellowship, Deacon Zeddy? Can we zip the kitchen? Pastor,
yes.
Do I have your permission for this?
Yes.
Yeah, so nothing. We're gonna go home. We're gonna go home and be taking this seriously. Because sometimes I've got to say, well, the message is gone. This is serious. This is an anointing that the Lord is looking to release, but is looking for vessels. To say yes, for me. You understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
Okay. So after the song is done, listen to the song, watch the video, whatever. Offering announcements, we love, we go. We humble ourselves.
Amen.
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 Not too much chatter to each other. Seriousness of the word. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.